Ladies and gentlemen, good evening and welcome to the Phoenix Comicon 2013 edition of the Awesome Hour with Wil Wheaton. Tonight's performance is released under a Creative Commons Attribution Non-Commercial Share Alike license. That means, find the nearest nerd and ask them. They are likely sitting next to you. Well, you are welcome to record in audio, video, and stone tablet fashion. This evening's performance, we ask that your recording does not interfere with the ability of the people around you to enjoy the show.
That means you.
We also ask that there be no flash photography, as flashes cause Mr. Wheaton to have seizures and turn into Cthulhu. You are also advised that this evening's program contains comedy of an adult nature.
Shake it off!
You are further advised to suck it. Ladies and gentlemen, it is now my pleasure to introduce to you TV's Wil Wheaton.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Wow, this is a very big, mostly empty room. It's great. I'd like to thank you for filling in the front seats so I don't feel this big on stage. I am so happy to be back in Phoenix. I've been coming to this con since the entire thing would fit in half this ballroom in Mesa. And it's been so great and exciting for me to see how this entire con has grown and how whoever is responsible for this magnificent event has managed to lower the temperature in the convention hall to sub-freezing. It's really been great. I've been making an effort this year to travel around a little bit and to go to some places that I haven't been in the last couple of years, because I'm out promoting my show Tabletop and the Big Bang Theory and Falling Skies Second Watch and some other things that I do. So my wife and I have been going around together. Our kids are growing, they're out of the house now, so we sort of get to go around and do things without the kids. And, you know, I thought that having the kids out of the house was sort of like a way to think about, like, oh, cool, we don't have to cook for as many people anymore, and I can sleep in, and I don't really have to do a lot of the, you know, full-time parent responsibilities, right? So I can tell you now that I had these thoughts before the kids were out of the house. So when my very conservative across-the-street neighbors had their kids move out of the house, and I went over to, you know, sort of congratulate them on, you know, raising two terrific young women and getting them out of the house. And I was like, so you guys must just be loving that the kids are out of the house. My very conservative across the street neighbors just turned bright red and looked mortified. And I'm like, sorry, I guess. I go home, I tell this to my wife, and I said, you know, it was like I had said to them, oh, the girls are gone, so you must just be fucking everywhere all the time. There must be like a cum slick in your living room. Like, you need to Zamboni the wood floors now, am I right? But that's not what I meant. What I meant was like, oh, it must be so nice that you can get out and do things. And my wife says, of course that's what they're doing now that the daughters are gone. So when our kids moved out, I was like, let's go. No, all it is now is, well, who's gonna do the dishes? Song Afternoon Delight is a bunch of bullshit. Fucking liars. We were just in Orlando, my wife and I, for a really fun convention out there called the MegaCon, which I'm told in French sort of translates into giant asshole, which I think, like, as a Californian, is a great way to describe Florida. And so we got there a few days early and went to Walt Disney World. And it was really fun. I really enjoyed it. We did this thing that they call drinking around the world in Epcot Center. And what this means is that you go to Epcot Center and they serve beers from all the different world pavilions in Epcot Center. So what this means in theory is you start in like Canada and you have a beer, and you go to England and then France and Germany. You go all the way around back to, I think you end in Mexico. You're supposed to have a drink every place that you go. But if you're like a craft beer snob like I am, what this means is that you go everywhere and you're just like really annoyed and disappointed until you get to Germany. And then you just get drunk in Germany. And then like you sort of stagger through the World Showcase at Epcot Center and you pick up you stamp your beer passport everywhere that you go. So one night we're leaving Epcot Center and we go to this big ice cream place. And Disney's really well known for like their great line management, their incredibly humane way that they treat their cast members, strong union protections. And in this particular area, you put in your order for your ice cream, and then you sort of get, like you go through and it's nice, right? There's a cash register and a human being and they talk to you and you engage in a business transaction and you're like, and there's ice cream at the end. But actually there's not, there's Thunderdome at the end because they've taken everybody from like eight lines and they've shoved like all into this room, right? So the week before we got to Walt Disney World, there was some kind of cheerleader convention. It was great, it went very well with the pedophiles convention that was happening on the other side of town near Universal Studios. And I'm watching this cheerleader mom and her like eight-year-old cheerleader daughter. They're standing in front of us. And the mom says this to the eight-year-old daughter. Look, I'm not gonna lie to y'all. First of all, y'all apparently is the singular and plural form of y'all. Y'all were real good on Friday. This is on a Monday. Y'all were real good on Friday when no one was there. But on Sunday, in front of Disney, y'all were terrible. She's eight, okay? And the mom is like, look, I don't wanna lie to you and give you false expectations, but y'all just didn't bring it. She's eight. So the little girl's like, she's like me, right? Like, we're in our own form of Thunderdome. I'm trying not to kill her mom for being such a bitch. And she's just like, Mom, stop being a bitch. And then the mom's like, come on, let's do it. Rock and roll, high school. And she starts doing, like, the cheerleader dance thing. And the girl's like, okay, I'm doing it. And I realize as I'm watching them that I have a front row seat to the origin story of a mean girl. Like, that woman is killing Batman's parents in the alley. And then I felt so sad, and I was like, kind of like in my mind, in my time machine mind, I was kind of like empathetic for all the awful cheerleaders and mean girls and stuff, and I was like, oh, that they had to endure this. But I thought, you know, like as a parent, you really try to relate to your children as best as you can. You try to have bonding experiences with them. So I imagine that they probably had a great bonding experience after they had their ice cream and her mom taught her how to throw it all up for the first time. So that's great. I'm really glad. That's good for them. I'm glad that they got to do that. So I like to cook with really hot, spicy foods. I'm really, really big fan of habaneros and jalapenos and stuff. I realize saying this in Arizona is sort of like saying, you know, I hate education in Alabama. But I love them, right? I'm crazy about them, right? So I have learned through trial and really the error part of trial and error that capsaicin stays on your fingers after me, right? So, like, I've done this a lot, right? You know, like, I feel like I want to have, like, a surgical scrub station in my kitchen now. The worst experience I ever had with capsaicin was a number of years ago. We put in some sod in our front yard. In California, we have grass where you guys have rocks. And it's great, except at night, the skunks would come out And they would sort of pull on the edges of the sod, and they would like yank it back and roll it back and then dig for grubs in the dirt. And I would walk out there every morning, and it was like, seriously? And I'd go out and have to re-roll the grass and put it all back and flatten it all back out. So I asked my neighbors, this is when their kids still lived at their house and they apparently weren't having sex all the time, what to do about that. Like, what do? You know, you live in the neighborhood, what's your plan? And the woman said, oh, you know what, go to Smart and Final and get a giant thing of red chili pepper flakes and then just put them around the edge of your yard and they won't want to go across it. And I was like, all right, I'm on it. So I do that and I walk around the perimeter of my yard, right, like just dumping handfuls of this stuff, just tons of it. I go through, like, probably, I think the 5 pounds was the smallest I could get there. So I'm like dumping it around and I put it around the whole perimeter of the yard, real proud of myself. I'm like, you know what, skunks, good luck. I go inside, go to the bathroom. Just go for like a really good, just a great pee. You know what I'm talking about, guys? Like one of those really great pees where you're just like, oh, I can keep peeing. This is great. And there's more pee. This is, God, I wish I was outside. I could have written half a novel. Like, that's just that kind of pee. And I go into the, like, I finish up, wash my hands, because that's important. Go to the bedroom and I'm like, huh. Hey, Ann. My dick's on fire. Don't worry, you didn't have anything to do with it. But I'm thinking maybe emergency room. She's like, no, don't be silly. Go, you know, go wash your dick off. Like, great, it's freshman year all over again. So I go to the bathroom sink, right? And I'm washing it all off, which is weird, because, like, I mean, it's just, it's odd. Like, it feels like I want to scrub it a lot, but it's kind of like jerking off, which is weird. And but it's not helping, right? It's actually getting hotter. So I begin to panic. And this is what my brain does. My brain goes, dude, hey, listen, I got you. Here's what you're gonna do. Milk makes things not spicy. There's milk in the refrigerator. I'm like, I like where this is going, brain. Let's do this. So I run into the kitchen and I grab the carton of milk out of the thing. Okay, no, I'm not a monster. I'm not gonna just tear off the lid of the carton of milk, okay? I pour the milk into a glass. I'm not making this up, this is 100% true. A glass that has a big happy face on it. And standing in the middle of the kitchen, I place my now just fiery, like oil well fire dick into the cup. And I'm standing in the kitchen like this. It is at this time that I realized my wife has been standing in the kitchen door laughing at me nonstop. And I've got nowhere to go because she's already lactose intolerant. I take it out, a glass full of spicy dick milk. And I don't want to waste it, because that's stupid. But I poured it in the drain. Eventually, the burning sensation went away. But I'm here to tell you, just based on that experience, college kids, use a condom. So, my wife endures a lot of that sort of behavior from me, because I was tested, I have the genius IQ, I'm very stupid when it comes to everything. She asked me if I would clean out our pantry, because there was one pantry pest in it. I don't know if those exist in the desert, but in LA, we have these tiny little bugs. I mean, they're small, they're tiny, that, you know, they're like, when you say, I will squash it like a bug, this is the bug you're thinking of. And they fly out of the pantry and they lay their little larva things in, you know, like your rice or your oatmeal or whatever. And according to my wife, if there's one, if you see one, there's 7,000 in the 8 cubic feet of the pantry, and everything has to be thrown away and cleaned out and thrown away. I'm like, look, I dumped out the dick milk. I don't really have a leg to stand on when it comes to food conservation. So I go ahead and I'm cleaning out the pantry. I have a question for you guys. I'm looking through my pantry as I'm cleaning it out, and I get to the canned goods section. Does anyone remember the great canned pumpkin shortage of 2007? Because apparently I was really stocking up for it. Or when, like, the Art Bell Show convinced us all in 1999 that kidney beans were going to be the currency of the post-Y2K future. Because I am so rich in that timeline. We had to throw it all away. And I know, it was terrible, and then I felt really sad about it. But again, dick milk, no place to stand. I was just in Calgary, and Calgary is in the same country as Ottawa, which is where this story takes place. I don't know why I said Calgary, sorry. You probably never would have known if I hadn't done that. I said a dumb thing, but then I totally saved it. I'm gonna tell everybody how I really screwed it up, so if you don't pay attention to that. Don't think of an elephant, everybody. Don't think of an elephant with its elephant dick and a glass of milk. You're doing it. So I'm in Ottawa for an Ottawa convention, and I get to go out to dinner with my boyfriend, Nathan Fillion. Nathan Fillion is that one place of the Venn diagram where my list and Anne's list overlaps. And he's great. I genuinely love him. Like, he's a great guy. He's fun, he's funny, he's charming, he's kind, he's great to be around. We're at dinner, and it was me and Nathan and Jewel Stade and Felicia Day and my wife and a couple of our friends. And for some reason, and I don't know how this happens, we start talking about the weird stuff our dogs eat. And then how those things manifest themselves in the dog poop later. And Nathan starts telling the story about how he was walking his dog, and his dog apparently had eaten a cassette tape. Right? Now I took, like, half of you were like, what? Why would a dog do that? And the other half of you were like, what's a cassette tape? And he describes how the dog's like, ah, you know, like pooping, and like, and the cassette tape is coming out of the dog, and it's, and like, and the poor dog is like, it's still in there, guys, like, come on, help me, please. So he's like, so I'm like, well, I guess I gotta help the dog, so I'm like, just pulling it out, and this must have been like a 120-minute cassette, because it just keeps coming out. And Nathan, he's going like this, and Felicia goes, you know, Nathan, if you do that, you could, like, it could mess up a dog's intestines and, like, bite and pull and hurt his intestines. And Nathan goes, wait, what? And he continues to slowly pull the pantomime tape out of the imagined dog's ass, which tells you that Nathan Fillion is an animal lover. I think that's great and wonderful. He didn't finish the story, so I don't know exactly how. He got all of it out. The worst I ever had to do was pull the entire, like, the string stuff that they use to tie up, like, a turkey roast. My dog got that, and that was rough. It was worse for me than it was for her, because I think she was like, you know, this isn't that bad. It's coming out, it's all right. I tried to send the video of it to a German porn site, and they rejected it. Really disappointing. I spent a lot of time online. It's sort of where I live. I joke that I'm from the internet, and Anne recently, Anne is my wife, by the way, if you don't know, when I talk about Anne, that is what I talk about, she's amazing. I know. That's me every day. Every morning I wake up and I'm like, oh, she's still here. There are literally 500 billion people on this planet, and I'm the one that she chose. And I don't know how much longer I'm gonna be able to like keep the shock thing on the leg working. She's gonna leave. So she's on Twitter and she's really funny. But every now and then, people like get all up on her shit about, like grammar Nazis really get up on her shit because she makes puns all the time, and they're great. And a couple of days ago, she was talking about how something was weird, right? And the way you spell weird is W-E-I-R-D, right? The way that I remember it is we are weird. That's my phenomenon. And some dude replies to Anna Twitter and goes,
excuse me, it's actually W-I-E-R-D because I before A.
And Emma's like, what is wrong with this guy? And I said to her, don't get upset about it. Don't take it personally. He is a grammar Nazi. The only way that he can come is when he corrects somebody. So these guys are like, and like the death of MySpace was like the death of you read porn too for these guys, right? Because they basically just sit around with one hand in their pants and the other hand on the screen is like, come on, just say your words, why don't you want? Come on, there! I feel sorry for those guys. I imagine that they walk around the world seeing everyone's mouth and a little red squiggle underneath them as they're mispronouncing things and saying things in the wrong way. I have a nephew. My little sister gave birth to my nephew just about a year ago, which means he's almost a year old. That's how math and time works. And he's awesome, and I adore him. He's the best. My sister asked me if I would be his godfather, which was such a huge honor for me. And she said, we want you and Anne to be his godparents because we're not nerds and we want you to be like his nerd dream. Well, fuck that, he's not gonna be, because in my mind, there's 3 Star Wars movies, and Padawans don't exist in any of them. And my sister was like, I don't know what that means, but I know that that makes you the perfect nerd coach right now. So she asked me to be his godfather. And Anna and I said that we would love to do that. And we went up to, this before we even met him, we told her that we would love to do this, so we went up to Portland, where they live, to visit him. And it was like, it was so exciting. I've seen him in pictures, I've seen him in little videos and stuff. And we went up to the house and we're on the porch of my sister and brother-in-law's house. And my brother-in-law's amazing. I really love him. He's a great father. He's an amazing husband. He makes my sister so happy. They're a wonderful couple together. The door opens and there's my sister with my little nephew like on her hip, and like her husband is like standing behind her all proud, and they just look like they're the perfect ideal of just like this wonderful happy family. And something in me breaks and I become the protective older brother, and I look at my brother-in-law and I go, did you fuck my sister? Don't fucking try to tell me that you didn't fuck my sister, dude. She's holding the baby. I can see it. Explain this. Tell me how it happened, man. Come on. My wife calmed me down. Which, for her, is a free action. Last one. we got through that, we went to the house. And I realized, as we walked into the house, that, okay, I don't really have to worry about him ever having sex with my sister again. Because he has a baby. Soul-crushing responsibility is going to be a way better big brother than I could ever hope to be in terms of cock blocking. It's going to be great. So they asked me if I will help train my nephew, and I say that I would love to. Now, here's what's very interesting. My brother-in-law, who, as we have established, I genuinely love him. He is a football guy. I know. I'm not a football guy. I'm pretty much the platonic opposite of a football guy.
attendees. I'm a hockey horse mask guy.
My brother-in-law is not just a football guy. He's a Dallas Cowboys football guy.
Wait, really? Is that good? I guess we're gonna have one of them famed convention riots I've heard so much about. Can you imagine that headline? Football riot breaks out at nerd convention. We literally never saw it coming, says everyone. The football guys fighting, all the nerds are like, you know what? We're just gonna let them kill each other. Go ahead. You guys are doing great. You're doing a good job. It's fine. Cheerleader moms off on the side, like, all right, here we go. So, because I'm trying to give him his nerd training, it's very much like he's Anakin Skywalker, and I'm Obi-Wan Kenobi, and my brother-in-law is a Dallas Cowboys fan. So, I'm so excited to be his godfather that the first thing I did was have a horse's head sent to their bed. So they would know that I take this seriously. And the second thing that I did was to go home and I got on the internet and I went to ThinkGeek and I bought for my nephew everything. Because I wanted to really just put my thumb on the scales right away, like just right out the door, right? My sister calls me as they arrive. I have them all shipped overnight, which I think the cost of the shipping exceeded the cost of the materials by like a factor of 1,000. It was very close to the gross domestic product of a lot of Caribbean nations once you take out the tax shelter income that they are providing there. My sister's like, what am I supposed to do with all this stuff? And I'm like, don't worry, that's what I'm here for. I'm going to train you. Why does my baby need a sword? Okay, first of all, that's not a sword, it's long claw. Great, why does he need long claw and 7 other swords? I'm like, I don't know. Make a mobile out of them. Put them over his crib. He'll see it every day and he'll be like, I'm gonna be honorable like Jon Snow. That's what we're doing. Solar radiometer, she says. Put it in the sun, Amy! That's what they're built for! It's not their fault that they don't have the nerd gene. No one really knows where the nerd gene comes from. Our parents don't have the nerd gene. Science doesn't understand the nerd gene at all, which is very ironic. My mom is obsessed with being cool. Super obsessed with people like thinking she's cool and like being presented properly. So when I tell stories on my blog about how when we grew up, my mom wasn't cool, I get a phone call. You're misrepresenting me, Will. That's not fair. She called me after seeing one of my stand-up acts. You know, you're misrepresenting me when you say I said you're misrepresenting me. Really, Mom, am I? Are you sure? Do you know what meta means, Mom? Okay, now you're just being disrespectful. Yes, I am. I wrote the story on my blog about how when I was a little kid, we would go on all these auditions all the time after school. Like, where normal kids would get to go, you know, do homework and play Star Wars figures and, like do power slides with dirt bikes and like make donuts with their green machines in the cul-de-sac, the industry. I was driving all over Los Angeles on auditions. And it's a kind of a strange existence for me as a kid. I ended up spending most of my time in my childhood in the car, which is weird. I think one of the reasons that I love music, and I especially love radio, I love curated music so much, because I spent all this time in the car with all these disc jockeys, and for a period, there was really great music in the car, and something happened to my mom. And my mom got really into Barbra Streisand. Yeah!
So I write this thing on my blog about how my we would go on auditions, and it was like my ears were being waterboarded by Barbra Streisand. I was like confessing to things that I had no idea. I was like, yes, I invaded the Falklands. That was me. Please turn it off.
My mom calls me after I write this post. You misrepresented me in your blog. Well, how, Mom?
Well, you said that we listened to Barbra Streisand, and that's just not true. That never happened.
Really, Mom?
Yeah, we listened to really cool music like the Doobie Brothers and Led Zeppelin and Pink Floyd and The Who. You're right, Mom, we did. Usually when Dad was driving me to auditions.
You were all about Barbra Streisand, Joan Baez, and Joni Mitchell.
No, that's not true. Mom, look, I don't want to argue with you, Mom. We never listened to Barbra Streisand. Mom, I am a woman in love, and I'd do anything to get you into my world. Why do I know that, Mom? Why do I know that? And I still can't do math in my head. Taking up space because of you, Mom. Don't appreciate me making me seem that I'm not cool to people on your blog. Oh, listen, the first thing you gotta learn, Mom, is to not give fucks about what people on the internet think. Like, that is what happens. You just gotta, like, one day, man, and this is great, this happened to me recently. One day you're gonna go to the fuck drawer where you keep all the fucks that you have to give about things, and you should be like, huh, there's no fucks in there. All right. Back to Reddit! Every now and then, though, somebody brings up something and you're like, oh, well, I guess I'll go over and see what's up. Oh, man. There's a fuck to get about that. It's back behind. I gotta search it out. Oh, got this fuck to give. Dear Fortune. I suggested that my mom should be sort of more like laid back like my dad. My dad doesn't care about anything. My dad's fuck drawer was emptied out, like probably before I was born. My dad is so laid back. He will walk around in Birkenstocks and Argyle socks and Bermuda shorts with a fanny pack and like in a Hawaiian shirt. Because my dad's like built for comfort, you know? He's like, oh, come on, this is great. I don't even need to go in my pockets for stuff. There it is, it's amazing. So my mom and my dad are like this really great combination of cool and comfort. They're like if Ferrari made a minivan, it would be my parents, and it would be called the Tempur-Pedic Rosa. Because that's who they are. So I'm hoping that the nerd gene that didn't get to my parents and didn't get to my sister, brushed up against my brother a little bit. It's recessive in him. He barely carries it. But it might be that because I'm such a strong carrier, which genetically gives siblings and everyone else within a 5-square radius of the party a +7 chance to actually become infected for 10 rounds. Save does not end. Gives them a chance to get infected with it. So I'm hoping that I give that to my nephew, who is my godson. Funny side story, when he was in utero, my sister did not want to tell anyone what his name was going to be because our mom has a lot of opinions about things. And really, you know, would probably whatever mom's preferred name was is how you are named Aloysius, right? So they wouldn't tell anyone what his name's gonna be, so I just started calling him Batman. Because I was like, it's great. He's like, he's not the son that you need, he's the son that you deserve. That could go either way, that's fine. That could be totally cool, maybe his first thing, maybe he won't say mom, he'd be like, I am the knight, I'm cool with that. She still asked me to be his godfather, knowing that these were the thoughts I was having about him. Makes me question her sanity, but that's cool, whatever. I started calling him Batman, and my sister said, if we call him Batman, then that means that his dad and I are gonna get killed in an alley. And I was like, first of all, amazing that you know that. Point. Second of all, that's actually what happened. His name was Bruce. Points back. I know, but I'm sorry. Part of being a nerd is being pedantic about things like that. I want to make the world safe for my nephew and everyone who's a nerd. I really want to make it comfortable for everyone who wants to unironically and enthusiastically love things. And I want it to be, like, okay. And it drives me crazy that the damn kids today are so, like, they're caught up in this weird, like, the Bieber world where they're so worried about, like, their swag. I don't even know what that is. I know what a lot of things are, you guys. I know stuff, I've seen some things. Like, I know the entire story of Goat Seed. Like, I can never forget it. I know, I was once invited to a lemon party and I went. It was awful. There were just two girls in one cup there. It was terrible. It was awful, I'm telling you. But I don't know what swag is. I know what YOLO means, which is kind of weird, and I think kind of misses the point, right? Like, maybe it's not like, I got a tattoo on my face because you only live once. It's more like, I was responsible, went to college, and saved my money so I'd have a happy retirement because you only live once. Like, come on, it's like, figure it out. So, I went to the Target so I can sort of like look down and maybe go to the Walmart. And I'm going there because I want to get a t-shirt. I was in like the Reddit t-shirt exchange, so I wanted to go get a t-shirt while I was there. And I'm walking in and I see on the wall, like on the wall of t-shirts, this really bitchin' Iron Man t-shirt. It's great. I'm like, I'm gonna have that t-shirt. It will be mine. I'm gonna own it and I'm gonna wear it. And then maybe someone will be like, I like Iron Man. And I'll be like, I know I like Iron Man too. That's why I have a t-shirt that says Iron Man. Let's talk about how great Iron Man is. Because that's what we do. So as I'm walking in, I see this kid. He's like, I don't know, he's like 11. And he's talking to his mom about how he needs to get this shirt. And he's like that weird combination of like really angry and wanting to cry, but also wanting to like appeal to mom, like that weird thing where like, and that's like the default, and for me anyway, that was my default state from like 11 to 16, right? It's like, I'm confused about everything. It's like my whole body felt like when my dick was on fire. Like, just, and it never stopped. It's 24/7, the kid's like, Mom! I have to get this shirt because I gotta keep my swag up at school! And my heart broke for this kid a little bit, so I went over to him and I was like, look, dude, I know that you think this swag is really important, but it's just not. And if you let yourself be defined by the clothes that you wear, then you're never gonna find out who you are. Like, you need to be important to yourself so that when the clothes go on you, they, like, accentuate who you are instead of being, like, what you are. And he looks up at me and I see the, like, realization starting to dawn on his face. I'm like, this is great. I'm getting through to this kid. And I say, look, man, like, let me give you an example. Over there, and I point and I see that some guy is trying to take the Iron Man shirt. So I knocked him down. I'm like, that's my fucking shirt, dude. Because YOLO, you guys. They sell Angry Birds underwear at Target. If I had more Angry Birds underwear, I would just shit myself all the time on principle. Because fuck Angry Birds, but also fuck me for wearing Angry Birds underwear. What's wrong with me? I tell you what I would love to wear are the Batman underwear that have a cape. Man, I can't sleep with anything on my upper body because I get really hot and also I just like to flex in my sleeve and I'm never trying to look into myself. And I get up in the morning and I'm a little chilly when I get up in the morning. morning, and I have this Captain Kirk bathrobe that I got from Thinking. It's gorgeous, I love it. So I put it on, and I'm like, all right, everybody, Captain is on the bridge. Like in just my boxers and my robe and stuff, and I make the coffee, and then I start to warm up, so I just sort of like pop the knot and I just let it hang open, and I'm like, oh yeah, I'm like rubbing the part of me that's still fat, like that won't go away, like no matter how much I work out, right? So I'm like, oh man, I just feel like I'm heaped as a bot in my living room. If I had fucking Batman cape underwear on underneath that, I guarantee you that there would be a Zamboni comes to across my and Anne wouldn't even have to be around. I found out recently that I had a secret admirer. And so, right, every time I tell this story, I hear from the audience, oh, you must have lots of secret admirers. I probably do. I will allow that. But this particular secret admirer sends me presents to my house, which is unlisted, which is weird. He sends me really awesome stuff. Complete Talking Heads discography. Right? Full-on super deluxe edition of Borderlands 2 with a Marcus Munitions bobblehead. Awesome. 2,400 Microsoft points, even though I already have 6,000 in my account. This guy gets me. He knows me. A membership in the Poutine of the Month Club. Really? He finally sent me the hockey horse mask that I wear. And that was when my wife realized that my secret admirer is drunk me. You ever really gross yourself out and try to figure out when you were conceived by backdating your birthday? I did that. That was a mistake. Every birthday, my dad sends me a picture of the VW bus I was conceived in, and he's like, just thought you'd like to remember. So, once I sort of sussed out the identity of my secret admirer, the relationship, it took on an interesting twist. He started leaving me notes around the house, but they didn't make a lot of sense. Which I guess does make sense in its own nonsensical way. There was one that says, just in all capital letters, Billy Ocean! Exclamation point, exclamation point, exclamation point. I'm like, I agree with you, drunk me. Billy Ocean, he's great. A monkey humping a palm tree, or maybe something else humping a pog. It's all pretty much the same. I'm not sure I follow your logic, drunk me. But okay, good for you. It was when drunk me left a bunch of signs all over the house, like a treasure hunt, that just said beer with an arrow, and beer with an arrow, and beer with an arrow, and finally it just ends in a wall, and I look up and it just says lol. That my wife says, it's time for you to break up with your secret admirer. This is uncomfortable. And I was like, but he gives me such nice presents. No, this is weird. This isn't cool. And I was like, look, he's clearly in love with me. How about a three-way? That did not go over well at all. So I decided to break it off with drunk me. He did not take it well. He sent me a Taylor Swift playlist he bought for me on iTunes. Then he sent me Fatal Attraction, which was weird. And I felt bad because, like, he likes me. He wants me to be happy. He wants me to have the things for me that I would never buy for myself, right? So I think maybe I'm just gonna keep him around a little bit longer. I'm just gonna let it like stay a little close to me, like until the PS4 comes out. fuck the Xbox One. But I'm gonna tell them, we keep the relationship like completely on the down low. Not gonna tell Adam about it at all. Like, stuff shows up, that's great. I'm just gonna put it in the closet, or I'll put it somewhere in the office. She doesn't know. Maybe when Adam's out of town, I'll let him come over and jerk me off. Because you guys, it's nice to have a sugar daddy. I think I have reached the end of the time where I talk at you, and we've reached the part of the show where you talk to me and I talk to you back. That sounds like fun. Let me look at this list of things that I wrote down and see if there's, yep, no, that's it, it's all there, yeah. Oh, you know what I forgot to tell you is that drunk me thinks it would be great if they made Buzz Lightyear shoes for adults. So, let's see, Ryan, there you are. House Ryan is here. As is the custom at a gathering of nerds such as these, we will have an exchange of questions and answers beginning now. If you would like to participate in the exchange of questions and answers, Ryan is here. Ryan's coming to the light. It's going to be good. Craig T. Nelson is there and he's going to hug you. It's going to be great. There you go. A little more. Let's get a little light in your face. There, stop. You're great. Amazing bow tie. That's lovely. You can come up to Ryan and like maybe if we just make a little line right down here, maybe line up like five or six at a time and then, you know, crouch down. We all know how to do this because we've been doing it since we were little, right? I was on the Jonathan Colton cruise last year and it was great, it was amazing. So we were out in the Caribbean the same time that the Carnival shit cruise was floundering in the Gulf of Mexico. And while we were all standing, like we're all on the ship, the Jonathan Colton cruise is like, it's like 1,500 nerds. And we're like engineers and scientists and entertainers. And like how I put engineers, scientists, and entertainers together. Like we're exactly the same. We contribute to the world in exactly the same way as you guys, I know. We were like, well, if anything floundered in this boat, we would organize in a second. We would be running this ship so efficiently. We would like have, there'd be like a line for food, and then there would be like another line for water, and then another line to poop over the side. And we'd have the whole thing all set up. People would have wristbands, and there'd be like a track for all the different survival mechanisms. So you should go on the Colton cruise, is what I'm saying, because if anything bad happens, we're totally fine. Engineers, scientists, and entertainers, you got everything covered. So Ryan, why don't you take your microphone and shove it into the face of the first person in line.
Step forward in the light.
Oh, that's right. Step in the light. Yes. Let's do this question and answer. Hi, how are you?
Good. How are you, Will?
I'm fine, thanks.
Okay. Do you have the horse head with you backstage?
I do not have the horse head with me backstage. The horse head only comes out on game days. The horse head is coming out tomorrow. And no, sorry, actually, no, it's not. The horse head is coming out on Sunday.
And are you going to crash John Derman's panel?
Am I? What's that now?
Are you going to crash John Derman's panel Sunday?
John Harriman is two seats down from me, and I've just been flirting with him since he sat down today. You guys, he totally blew me a kiss, and I caught it, and I put it right in my mouth.
On my autograph thing that you signed for me earlier. I'm not going to repeat it because that is not nice words, but thank you.
Well, what this audience doesn't want to hear now is not nice words.
Yeah.
Was it something like, may the cops look in your kitchen, may forever be Zamboni?
No, it's Wil Wheaton, a bad motherfucker.
Oh, that's right.
The next thing,
that's
true. And my work, which is a junior high, I don't care what they say.
You're going to, well, listen, I hope that you have alternative employment lined up. What is your question?
All right, I just wanted to ask, what was probably your favorite game to record and do on tabletop?
Thank you. That's that your boss tells me that some of you watch tabletop. That's great. Thank you. Probably my favorite has not aired yet, and it's probably Lords of Waterdeep. Just because that's my favorite game that I'm playing right now. It's a super great game. We're about to go into production on the back half of the season, and we're going to play, we're playing games like Ticket to Ride Europe. I have invited my wife and Wheaton to come back and play again. Remember that thing I said about how I'm stupid in everything? Real funny story about that. She, you know, she hit the table when we were playing Ticket to Ride last season and knocked like 180 plastic trains off the thing. And it was at the end of the day, long shooting day. We were all like really tired and we were like, what's going to happen now? Well, like 24 hours earlier, I called her and I said, listen, we had a cancellation and I really would love it if you would come and play on the show. And the first thing she says is, I don't want to screw anything up. And I'm like, you're not going to screw anything up. Are you kidding me? You're brilliant, amazing. Like, you'll have a really good time. No, I'm really going to screw up the game. Trust me, sweetie, you're not going to screw up the game. So she screwed up the game. So now, when we go anywhere, I'm like, listen, sweetheart, you're not going to get your road hit. I know it's not going to happen. I just want to know that I'm really clear with that. It doesn't work, guys. It doesn't work. Thank you for your question.
Hi, I'm Miss Kelly.
Hi, Kelly.
And how you enjoyed working with the
set
of the Big Bang Theory.
Oh my God. Working on the Big Bang Theory is the best thing ever. You guys, they are the nicest, funniest, kindest people in the world. None of them are nerds like we are. None of them are like the characters. Probably the nerdiest person on that set is probably Kaylee. And the thing is, some of you may have heard me say that being a nerd or being a geek is not about what you love, it's about how you love it, right? So it's not like, it drives me nuts when someone's like, you don't like Doctor Who, so you lose nerd points, or you don't watch Firefly, so you lose nerd points. First of all, who said that you get to give out nerd points? That's my job. Right? I don't recall seeing you at the meeting where we discussed the distribution of nerd points, Felicia. I'm just kidding, she's great. But Kay is a huge book nerd. She loves to read, she's a huge fantasy nerd. One of the first episodes I worked on, there's a place over at Warner Brothers where you can go have a sorting hat from Harry Potter put on you. Yeah, so she's like all about Harry Potter, right? So she goes to lunch one day to get sorted with the Harry Potter hat, right? And she's all excited because she knows she's going to be a Gryffindor. And I'm like, well, no, you're going to be a Hufflepuff. I know it, blah, blah, reasons. I don't know what they were. I'm like, okay. Lunch is over, Kaylee comes back. So, who'd you get sorted into? I don't want to talk about it. Hufflepuff? I don't want to talk about it. Okay, have a good time in Hufflepuff. We're going to talk about you in Slytherin tonight. Hello, sir.
Hello, and good evening. This is my first Comicon.
Welcome.
Externalizes with dressing up.
Right.
And I think they call it the cosplay.
That's what it's called, yes. It is my absolute favorite expression of love for a thing.
Yeah. And I think there's the other type of fan like myself that internalizes.
Yes.
And wear it on the inside.
Yeah.
And to quote Star Trek, I should have done this a long time ago. But this is not a Star Trek question. The question I have is, you were in two of my favorite movies. First is Stand By Me.
Thanks.
And the second is The Last Starfighter, which a lot of people do not know that we were in. And I know that from what I've kind of studied on the internet, that there was a
scene. Whoa, hang on, you can study things on the internet?
There's this thing called the internet.
No, excuse me, don't condescend to me, sir. I don't think I was under the impression that the internet was a place for cats doing hilarious things. Entirely about cats deciding whether or not to buy a boat. That is my understanding of what the internet is made for, sir. Now, if you've experienced a different internet than I have, I'm very happy for you. But please do not assume that I know what the internet is. Because my good experience has been different from yours. Now, if you'll please continue with the question.
So I was on the internet.
Right.
And I found that there was some scene that you had dialogue in.
Yes.
Cut. So
yes.
My question is, what was that, and do you know why that was cut?
Yes, I know both of those. I know answers to both of those questions. I choose not to answer them because you don't know about cats on the internet. So the scene is, so what happened is, in the movie The Last Starfighter, I was cast to play Lewis's friend. Lewis is Alex's younger brother. And we have this scene where we're camping out in a teepee when the spaceship comes down and lands. The spaceship lands twice in the movie. This is the first time the spaceship lands in the movie. And we look out and I go, "Hey, aliens!" And Lewis goes, "Wicked!" And we go right back inside the tent. I can't believe they decided to cut that scene. Because it tells you a lot about who I am. I'm an 8-year-old kid who is really into aliens. I spent weeks in the actor's studio working out all of the backstory for who that kid was at great personal expense. The scene was actually cut before we even filmed it, and it was just because the movie was running long and it didn't add very much to the movie, allegedly. But I had already been filmed as a background performer in some scenes. Now, a lot of people see The Last Starfighter and they think that I'm the big kid in the red shirt running with the football. That's not me. I'm the little 8-year-old kid in glasses and cowboy pajamas, because they let me bring my own wardrobe. And I was seen in a few scenes, and there were reunion rules back then were that if you were a named character, whether the scene was filmed and made it to Final Cut or not, if you've been filmed at all, then you would be in the credits, right? So every year, I get a residual payment for like $300 for The Last Starfighter, for scenes where I ran around. And I get it, and I go, I take the bank, and I go, "Alien!"
First, I'd like to thank you for all the hours and hours of God knows how much fun we've had playing the tabletop games.
I love that. Thank you.
Don't say anything because you're really great, but is there one game in particular that you'd love to play that for whatever reason you can't show on tabletop?
Oh, there's a lot of games that I'd love to play on tabletop. Dominion, Agricola, Cards Against Humanity. I love Seven Wonders, Ascension, Battlelore, Magic the Gathering. These are games that I love that would be great, but they just do not work for our format. There's a trend toward these games right now where everybody kind of plays at once and it's kind of a frenzy and there's a thing going down. So there's like Space Cadets is like that, and Space Alert is like that, and Escape from the Temple of Something is like that. And they're super fun games, but because everything happens at the same time, it's just not possible to film it and put it on the show. I have this idea to do a thing called the Tabletop Spotlight, where I actually spotlight some of those games and just say, look, people ask us all the time, this is a game, this is Eclipse. Eclipse is amazing, but it takes 7 hours to play, so we can't play it. And you know, sort of introduce people the way that I would hope that a game shop would, but doing it through to the internet for people who don't necessarily have access to a game shop. And thanks for watching our show.
You said that a lot of your childhood was spent in the car driving around LA going to auditions.
Yeah.
Was that your choice or were you forced into doing that? And did your brothers and sisters have to do that as well?
You know, I wouldn't say that I was forced, but I would say that I didn't have a choice. I would say that the choice was made for me before I was old enough to really know what I was doing. I was talking about this earlier today, and I can't remember a time in my life when I wasn't an actor. I don't remember just having a normal childhood life that's like go to school, come home, dirt bikes, you know, repeat. I don't remember that at all. But because I didn't really know what I was missing out on, I just sort of accepted that that's what life was, that's what it was going to be like. There were times where I would just get completely fed up with sitting in traffic all the time. To this day, I will not go places. Like, if my friends move to Santa Monica, they're effectively dead to me. Because they may as well be north of the wall. I'm never going there. It will never happen. I'm Dothraki and Hollywood is the ocean. I'm never going across it. And I didn't make that connection until this moment. That's why I get so mad when I'm driving. But, you know, there's a point in my life fairly recently where I thought about that, where I thought, like, I started to feel sad for the childhood that I didn't have. And I started to feel sad for the perception of the childhood that I didn't have, and I realized as I sort of deconstructed it that the childhood that I did have eventually led to the life that I have now. And the life that I have now can be best summed up thusly: I hope I never wake up. So, it's really important to me that my own children had a normal childhood, and I gave them the best normal childhood that I possibly could. And help them, you know, not feel that sense of like, you're 9, why aren't you acting like a 40-year-old? Which is kind of the environment that I was in when I was younger. And thanks for your question.
How's it going? I actually want to say thank you for doing Tabletop.
Thank you.
I've been introducing non-gamer friends to games through it for about 6 months.
Excellent. That's the mission statement.
I've actually got a whole bunch of people who've never played a tabletop game before riding around Fiasco playsets.
Excellent. Games. Really good.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Tabletop related question. Who is the favorite guest you had on Tabletop? And it could be one that we haven't seen yet in the next season. I know Pat Roth has his. But, and also,
that's actually on his resume. Hello, I'm Pat Roth.
How do you spell it? No, anyway, and who would be the guest that you just your absolute reach in a million years, you never think you could get him, but you really want to get him on the show?
It'll be fun. I believe the question was for me, sir. I said, who would be, I really loved everybody on the show. It was really fun when Anne played on the show because she got to sort of be there and experience firsthand and sort of what I do, what my job is. I really loved having John Rogers on because we play Fiasco outside of the show, and Fiasco with writers is amazing. And that was really, really super great. As far as who I would really love to have on the show, your mom. It's such a hard question because it's like, I feel like I should just wish for wishes. If I can have anyone on the show, it would probably be Karen Gillan and Zoe Deschanel playing a game I wrote called Make Out People Week. Maybe the one time that I lose on Tabletop, but I still win. Hello, what is your question, young lady?
Hi, I'm a huge fan. I think you're awesome.
Thanks.
I didn't know that you were a craft beer fan. I am one as well, and I'm wondering
Excellent.
If you had any favorite beers or any recommendations you could give me.
You have to tell me what style of beer you like to drink.
I love pretty much everything, but the broad category is IPA, Stouts, Lambics.
Okay, so for IPAs, you've got some really good ones locally. Hop Knot was really good. From San Diego County, Ruination IPA from Stone Brewing Company. The IPA from Odell is really good. You can go, they got me, Odell! And then laugh really hard because you saw that thing on the Home Shopping Channel, but apparently I'm the only person in this room, which is why that's only funny to me. Torpedo IPA from Sierra Nevada is quite good. Surly Furious and Surly Aggressive from Surly up in Minnesota are phenomenal. If you can get your hands on Pliny the Elder or Blind Pig from Russian River, those are really, really good. Also, the Pompey the Great that I made, which is based on the recipe of Pliny the Elder, is extremely good as well. I absolutely love craft beer, and it's one of the reasons I'm so this still. That's why I'm still in L and not quite in M. It's fair trade. Thanks for your question. I've gone over. We're now into the awesome hour in 4 minutes. You're getting free awesome hour, everybody. I'm really glad that you're happy and not ready to leave because that makes me feel good. We'll only go for a little bit longer because it's going to be a great night out there in Los Angeles and the Radio Man's going to receive us. So go ahead and ask me a question, please.
I noticed, and, you know, I've talked to you about this, you know, you get dice from your fans, and I've watched you on YouTube do D&D epacks, and I've seen, you know, on your tabletop. Do you use those dice? Because I know there's a rule of don't touch another.
Well, once dice are gifted to you, they become your dice. So I actually have close to 50 pounds of dice at home. And yes, I do use them all the time. I have my little bag of dice that I've had since I was a kid, and those just sort of stay in the bookcase, and just, like, they're wonderful and memento, but, like, people have given me dice that matter to them, so when I play games that involve dice, I just go up and I reach into the bag of dice, and I root around, stab myself a bunch of times on D4s, and then pull out and organize what I need. Yeah, thanks for your question.
Hello, my name is the Ice King.
Hello, Ice King.
My question is,
are you the real Ice King?
I steal friends with bubble gum.
That would explain why it's so motherfucking cold in the convention center. I went to the t-shirt place and I was like, I'm freezing. Can I have a hoodie? Can I buy a hoodie from you? And the t-shirt guy looks at me like, I'm insane. We're in Phoenix. Memorial Day. Why do you need a hoodie? And I'm like, have you been in this room? Anyway, Mr. Ice King, if you would continue with your questions, please.
When I heard about your stories and your singing capability, I feel like I want you to think about your life, like the Lonely Island. Deeply fucking.
Improv training in me wants to say yes and, but the person in me who actually knows what I sound like when I sing has to say, you're welcome, no. But it is an excellent question. Thank you for keeping it so miserably cold at the convention center.
I just
want to
say hi.
Hi.
So awesome to be here and all that. And
well,
then,
thanks.
My question is kind of a two-parter.
All right.
I was wondering what your favorite acting job you've ever had was, and if you're able to, like, watch stuff that you were in without
freaking
out.
It took me a really long time to get used to watching myself as watching my performances, because all I could see were the things that I thought I did wrong. And part of that is useful as an actor, because it helps me learn and grow and continue to develop as an actor. But then it also sort of, like, just makes it impossible to just enjoy what I'm doing. So it took me a really long time. I had to kind of get out of my own way, and I think that a lot of it had to do with just growing up, and also just running out of bucks to come about things. I cannot stress enough how important it is to empty out the fuck drawer, you guys. But I think, you know, it's very hard to answer that question. It's very much like, which one of your children do you love the most, right? I've loved everything that I've done for a different reason or another. I'd have to say that the thing that I miss the most, where I really feel like a sense of loss that I'm not going to go back to it, is you. You're very welcome. Thanks for your question. Let's probably take 5 more minutes ish, and then I'll get out of your way and let you do whatever you do in this room. I know all good things have to come to an end.
Hi. Drag Felicia Day out here next year, because it would be super kick-ass awesome.
Like, drag her by the hair like I'm a caveman?
Yes.
Like, straight across the desert?
Yes!
It's not really how I roll, but...
Just saying, okay.
Maybe I can put her in a Hannibal Lecter thing and just wheel her across.
She's a gym and she has no soul, so...
Listen, I know that she has no soul. Tell me something I don't know. Would you like a thing that has flavor, or a thing that is used to describe things that are awful and boring and have no flavor at all? Chocolate all the way. Although I will tell you this, I once made a jalapeno ice cream where you chop up jalapenos wearing gloves every day, and then you put them into vanilla ice cream. It's terrific. A little graham cracker in there is nice as well. Yes, sir. Good question.
I was wondering what your favorite Talking Heads or David Byrne song is.
Oh, This Must Be the Place. is like just million miles my favorite Talking Heads song. I think Stop Making Sense is one of the greatest concert films and albums ever made. Speaking in Tongues is probably my favorite overall Talking Heads album. No, thank you. All right. There's a fairly, there's like a half thing. I don't want to keep you guys here if you want to leave. So the majority will rule. If you want to just have a lightning round through the rest of this, or this could be the end and we'll go. Lightning round? Or, seriously, we can keep overstaying your welcome. Really, nobody has the courage to do that? My craziest fan slash con experience was me going up to Peter Dinklage and Lena Headey at Calgary and going, I love you so much. And them saying, won't you sit down and have a drink with us? And it happened. And Lena Headey kept thinking of me and talking to me on purpose. Conversation with me that was way beyond just polite. And then the next night, Peter Dinklage was like, oh, hello, come sit, let's have a drink together. And we did it again. It was amazing.
Okay, so basically you were the Bob magazine from my age 10 to 12, okay?
Oh, right.
Right, yeah. And I just wanted to know if that ever had any really negative side effects on you.
Oh yeah, it really did. It made me feel like a three-armed person. Yeah, the whole Teen Magazine thing was really weird and uncomfortable for me. I was never comfortable with the publicity and promotion and attention, that particular kind of attention. Now, as an adult, it's really cool to meet people who are like, look, you were in these magazines, and that was meaningful to me when I was a kid, and I feel great. I feel really good that a thing that I did was somehow able to be part of a person's life in a positive way that I never even knew about. And I hear these amazing stories from people all the time about watching Star Trek or you know, how they did things with their friends and how that stamp I think played into that. But it's really great, and it's really wonderful. At the time, I really didn't like it. It made me really, really uncomfortable. Because I didn't like myself. I was a weird, awkward teenager. I felt uncomfortable. I was unsure. I was convinced that there was something wrong with me because I was such a nerd for stuff. And back then, you guys, it was not okay like it is now. There was people were cruel to you, right? I was in Kansas City and I was walking to dinner with a bunch of comic writers. And the guy drives by in a car and he gets out the car and he goes, nerds! And my friend Jerry Duggan, who's with us, goes, hey, it's 1985 in that car! Nobody cares about me because they don't want to know what my favorite band is. They don't care. Like, it's just because it's weird stuff with the Teen magazines. But now that I get to meet adults who are like, no, it was really cool. And then they bring me like the pictures and the scrapbooks and stuff, and I'm like, oh, well, that feels really new.
Okay, weird question I'm asking for her. She has your dice
card. Oh, dude, I know that feel, bro. Sorry.
I've been your fan for a long time, and she's liking dice.
Yeah, you know what? Embrace it. Just get used to it. You're going to roll to see if you don't fall down, and you're going to fall down. That's how it works.
Hi, Will.
Hi.
I was introduced to you not through normal stuff. I actually first learned about you with the Penny Arcade Expo.
Yes.
You games with those versions.
Oh, thanks.
PAX is really far away from Phoenix. I was wondering if you had any plans on expanding something similar to other cons. I'd love to see something like that going here.
I thank you. We've talked about that. The reality is it's very expensive to put it on. And it's very hard to do. And the reason that we've done those Acquisitions Incorporated games once a year at PAX is because of that, because it's a huge production to put it all together. But it's easier to take me there than to take the entire apparatus somewhere else. That said, we at Geek & Sundry are working on a way to do a tabletop roadshow. I don't know what it's going to be, I don't know how it's going to be, but that is the thing that we are working on. And I'll put Phoenix on the list.
Of course, it's to never go.
Sorry, I turned to John Roderick for a second there. Go ahead, that's your question. Yes. As a matter of fact, that happened when I sat down to have drinks with Peter Dinklage and Lena Headey.
Alright, so I've seen you talk to John Green on Twitter and stuff.
Yes.
Did you read the Fault in Our Stars?
Of course I did.
Did you cry?
Of course I did.
Sorry, I'm kind of nervous.
That's alright. You were great. Here, I'm right here. Go ahead.
Sort of like
fandoms,
you know, like Supernatural, Doctor Who, Doctor
Who, the entire universe, the entire Game of Thrones universe, and some literary stuff, like all of Mark C. Danielewski's, and I always say his name wrong, like the guy that wrote House of Kings, and stuff like that. And music. So I love like classic rock, and I'm a little bit of a guitar nerd, and I'm a beer nerd.
Oh, that's
really cool. Thank you for your question. You did great. Applaud for her. I'm glad that you're here in a red shirt, because as long as you're here, I'm basically immortal. As long as you're here, I have an extra hit point, and that's fantastic. So. Oh, it's a horror shirt. Excuse me, madam, I stand corrected.
I'm gonna
move on. Okay, good, you're in a red shirt. Excellent, thank you, Ryan. Thank you.
First, thank you for the image of John Brown and blowing your kiss.
Dude, if you think the image was great, you should have been there for the thing. Yeah.
Secondly, I'm trying to get a promotion in my clan in Darkfall. And
I know some of those words.
I needed to do something truly epic, so I was just wondering if you could say as an Ashdosi doll your shows and going for dancer moves.
Say this is all in his name. Dancer rules. Promotion, not because like I'm lame and can't do your thing, but because you had the courage to come in front of a room full of strangers and ask me to do that. That's why you get the promotion. That is what happened. Hi.
My favorite role that you ever played was Mushy Shorts on the gorgeous tiny
chicken. Oh, I love Mushy Shorts.
I just want to hear any amusing anecdote.
So the best part about that is that we shot in the back of Greg and Kim's garage, which is not the way a lot of legitimate stories start out, but is actually the way a lot of stories about videos on the internet start out. It was unbelievably hot, and it was Payman Benz as the, Payman was the unicow, and then Sean Becker was the counticorn. And Sean Becker was pumping my face with his counticorn udders, and it was the funniest thing I'd ever experienced in my life. And Andy Suriano was a brilliant artist and animator, played my Russian bride, which was super great. But that was a lot of fun. I had a good time doing that part. It's a gorgeous tiny chicken machine show, if anyone's wondering what we're talking about. Go ahead.
Hi, I was just wondering if you're going to be having any time soon to dust off your belt and use more radio-free burrito.
Yeah, I've been working on doing more radio free burritos, but it seems that every day that I go to do that, they decide that they're going to just start imploding buildings in my neighborhood, and it gets really loud. So thank you for your question, thank you for listening to the burrito. And it is something that I really love to do, but I only like to do it when I've got really have something, like I'm super inspired and I have a thing to do and say. And I'm working on secret projects right now that are kind of taking away all of my creative energy. And it's when I come here and people are like, oh yeah, there's actually people who listen to that and enjoy it, and I forget that, that I think, I really need to make a burrito. So, I'll make a burrito soon.
Hi, Will.
Hi.
I'm wondering if you have any advice for a first-time dungeon master who's really investing in storytelling and role-playing.
Oh yes, absolutely. The most important thing when you're a DM is to facilitate the story for your players. You need to let your players know that their actions have consequences. You need to let them know that they're not immortal. You need to make sure that your players understand that sometimes it's okay to retreat from a fight. But you, as the DM, can set up encounters that really reward role-playing. And as a DM, you can reward role-playing. One of the ways that I encourage role-playing in my group, if somebody rolled, like, really just needed to make a roll and they blew it, I would give them an opportunity, like, all right, you can, through role-playing, explain to me how you bowed this thing, but how you recovered, and if it's good and true to your character, I'll let you roll again. That even gets power gamers to work on storytelling. And you have to also understand that not every gamer wants to be a storytelling gamer. So make sure that you choose your group really well. And if you want to play, a game that is heavily invested in storytelling, I would say go away from like 4th edition or Pathfinder and go toward like Fate. Or one of these systems that is really where you're all working together to build a world and tell a story. You're welcome. Oh, you should always try to say yes. When they want to do a thing, you always want to try to say yes. Okay.
Hi, Will. Thanks for the upvote earlier.
Oh, you're very welcome. Well,
I was wondering, what is your favorite black and white card against humanity card?
My favorite white card is a big black dick. Followed very closely by Pac-Man uncontrollably guzzling cum. My favorite black card is what went through Michael Jackson's mind in his last minutes of life, or however that's worded. The Trump card that wins that one always is exactly what you think in our game. I really like the one about what did Sean Penn take to the people of Haiti after the earthquake? And the last time that came up, the card that won was the gays. I know, I'm a horrible person for thinking these things are funny, and every time I talk about it in public, like the social justice Tumblr people go crazy about it. But it's amusing to me. God, Tumblr was down one day, and I was like, where am I going to go to get lectured by self-righteous 20-year-olds with no life experience? Good luck.